Yeah, it has it on here. Yeah, mine does. A stranger in the council.
That's right. New haircut, new day.
I don't know, man. Stranger.
You got a grown man hair. I'm just kidding. I'm just jealous because I don't have a lot of hair left.
No, it's my only job.
Right before this started getting really bad, I gave it one last college try. I look like Yeah, but I have lots of hair. I have less hair than Chad Charlie does. So I asked, and I assume nobody's going to talk to me. If we can do it tonight, if they have to do it up to the front, so I don't have to think about all this stuff.
What's up, Freeport? It's your Councilman Mario Moreira, and today we have a special meeting. We're going to be talking about redistricting, and it's something that occurs every 10 years, and it's just based on every ward and how we look at how the population has changed and see if we have to add more neighborhoods or add more neighborhoods to other wards to kind of level it out. So right now, basically what we're gonna go through is a resolution, pretty much take action on it. We're gonna be establishing guidelines for people that, for individuals that wanna submit specific redistricting proposals and provide comments. Also, we're going to have criteria. We're gonna be adopting criteria for use in the 2022 redistricting process. We're gonna be, and we're also gonna have a drawing session by Baker staff for the redistricting of the wards. And I'll be showing all that. We have it on the screen right now, on the computer screen. Then the last thing is, it's a discussion and take possible action on a joint public hearing to take action on an ordinance to amend the zoning ordinance to have to permit residential development on the first floor in downtown. That's something that you see like in areas like San Antonio, Houston. You see how there's zoning ordinances that don't permit business owners to have residential on the first floor on buildings, and mostly the historical buildings. We don't have that many folks showing up today, but it's a special meeting.
So this is her computer, so everything she does is mirrored on all the screens.
Okay.
It's not, Facebook did not want to stream it as well. So Facebook's connected to the camera, but it's not going to show the presentation.
We're not able to live stream the presentation.
Yes, sir.
So if you're able to,
yeah, I'll be able to
live stream the presentation.
Yes, sir.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I am now going to call this special meeting of Freeport City Council to order. This Wednesday, October 26, 2022, at 6 p.m. Please excuse me. I've been dealing with a cold, so I sound a little different. I will declare that all the notices have been given. I will declare that the quorum is present, and I will now officially call this meeting to order. At this time, Mr. Kelty, would you lead the certification and the Pledge of Allegiance, please, sir?
Thank you, Mayor. Right. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day. We thank you for all the blessings that you have bestowed on each of us. Please continue to watch over the city of Freeport and guide us. Bless each of our elected officials and everyone here in participating in this meeting. Lord, we ask that all decisions and discussions and conversation all be pleasing to you. We ask all this in the name of your Son. Amen. Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Honor the Texas flag. I pledge allegiance to thee, Texas, one state, under God, one and indivisible.
Thank you. You may be seated. Thank you. Are there any citizen comments? Ma'am? And I also can't hear.
I haven't turned it in yet. Sir.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am. Ms. Nancy, do you want to speak now?
No, sir. I'll wait. I'm learning it up.
All right. Thank you, ma'am. We'll now go into council business regular session. At this particular time, Manny, do you want to speak now?
No, so I need to run.
Okay. Thanks. Council business regular session. If the requests are legal, we're going to take things out of order. He's got he's gracious to be here for our special meeting tonight, but he has some other business that he has to take to as well. And I figure since we'll have two folks that either one of y'all lawyers. All right, there we go. I thought that last time, so we'll be safe. We've got a lawyer present. So. With that, we'll take up item number 4, discuss and take possible action for a joint public hearing. And take action on an ordinance to amend the zoning ordinance to permit residential development on the first floor in the downtown district. Mr. Kelsey and or Mr. Goodman.
I asked for this particular agenda item here to be on tonight's meeting so that we could formally call for a joint public hearing between the planning commission and the council with in accordance to the announcement requirements by law. Simply put, that's the gist of it. I guess in the interest of time, I'll just make the motion for a joint public hearing to take action on an ordinance to amend the zoning ordinance to permit residential development on the first floor in the downtown district.
And before we do that, Councilman, yes, sir.
I just kind of wanted to have a discussion about approval of this type of thing. So in Section 211.07 of the Local Government Code, a city council can prescribe by ordinance a joint public hearing with the zoning commission. If they deviate from the notice requirements, and the current notice requirements are not only, if y'all remember, the 15-day publication notice, but also the 10-day mailer, since the 14th Court of Appeals has determined that even a regulatory change constitutes a change in zoning classification. So if you want to maintain that same level of notice, it's a simple majority vote. If you want to deviate, it requires 2/3 votes. Since there's 4 voting members here, that would be 3. So I just wanted everybody to be aware of that before motions are finalized.
And Councilor Pinion, I apologize. There is a Mr. Pinnerfield would like to speak on item number 4. Are you comfortable with speaking?
I am.
All right, Mr. Pinnerfield.
City Council had adopted an ordinance that would drive me to my home. I started paying attention to what was going on with the council. And also tried to find out why you would enact an ordinance that would force me out of my home. And I found out that it was the Main Street program, Main Street Committee, that their literature, their training says that residential use of the downtown doesn't fit well with their image of what a downtown should be. And one thing I'm surprised that this went through code enforcement, it went through planning, and it went through you guys, and nobody caught that issue, that it would definitely throw people out of their homes. And I noticed that the conversation about residential use downtown seems to be superficial. It's just very shallow. There's no substance to it. And nobody asked Main Street Committee, some tough questions. One thing that struck me is why they need to do the whole downtown historic preservation. Granted, Park Avenue definitely has a historical value. There is a sentimental, emotional attachment to it. But immediately south of that, you've got the Simmons Lumber property, also in the downtown district. And nobody has any sentimental attachment to that, but yet the Main Street Committee says we have to put our influence in that area too. They don't seem to recognize or acknowledge that there are different sections of the downtown. Some of them worth preserving, some of them not. And this whole blanket regulation that covers the whole downtown is kind of an overreach. It just seems kind of wasteful. I've been in communities where they had downtown redevelopment and there was substance to the plan. The Main Street Committee was up here with a lot of enthusiasm, a lot of commitment, but nothing of substance. And they didn't even do a survey of count the number of historic buildings. As far as I know, there's been no commitment from any kind of business or any kind of bond money from the city or just any concrete plan. It's just enthusiasm and commitment, and nobody looked into it enough, put enough time and effort into it to ask some hard questions. And so I think the first thing the Main Street Committee did was got you all to ban residential use. And they did that with just enthusiasm and commitment, and nobody pressured them for a plan. And so I think you all jumped the gun on this, and you need to go back and look at it again. And if somebody comes to you just arrogantly confident that they have the solution to how to revitalize the downtown, I don't care who it is, whether it's EDC or Mr. Kelty or Jeff Painter or whoever, start asking questions and take a deeper dive into this, and you won't have this situation where you create an ordinance that throws people out of their homes. So just my criticism of the whole thing.
Thanks, sir.
Thank you.
Very good. Mr. Binion, Councilman Binion, your report, sir. You made the motion?
Yes.
I don't know about item number four. Ms. Roshan has a general comment, but I was going to get to this matter first before I look
sure.
At
just clarification here in terms of the motion. Mr. Olson, making sure that the motion is as was written on the agenda, but amended to send a 10-day mailer notice to all property owners in the downtown district within 200 feet of the downtown district boundary lines.
And just for clarification, the motion is to approve the ordinance as presented, but amended to include a 10-day mailer.
That is this particular.
The one in front of council. We'll need to add a day to.
Yeah.
So and I know Tim and I have done the math, and it looks like the first available date
would be November 16th.
16th or 17th.
Is a 10-day notice and the first
day mailer or a 15-day publication?
Okay. And then so the earliest that would be is the 16th or the 15th? I think the 15th is a Wednesday. Or is that a Tuesday?
It would be the 16th or the 17th, depending upon how soon the newspaper got published. I anticipate that they would be able to get it published by Tuesday the 1st. If we send it to tomorrow morning,
I'll find the 16th as the date.
Okay.
Motion.
Do you need to reiterate it?
I think that's sufficient.
Okay.
So we have a motion on the floor. Is there a second?
No second.
We have a second from Councilman Mariah. Discussion. Mr. Kelty, has the administration proceeded with setting forth the notice to the folks within the downtown district of 200 feet?
Yes, so the notice has been published in the newspaper for a special meeting of the Planning Commission.
What day would that be?
For the 15th. And for a public hearing before council on the 21st.
So we've already paid for notice and planned for a planning meeting on the 15th of November and a council, special council meeting on the 21st.
And notices have also been made on all property.
Notice has been sent out to these states.
Okay. That is for November 21st or December?
November.
November 15th for the Planning Commission and November 21st for council. This ordinance would set a joint meeting for the evening of the 16th.
Yeah, Mayor, I had made this request here previously to Mr. Kelty, and so I'm not sure how things got lost in translations to have this joint meeting, and the effort was to try to make sure that both the zoning and planning and zoning board would be available in attendance the week of the 16th. But my larger concern was that it was going to be a two-part where most folks would be out of pocket the week of the 21st because that's Thanksgiving. And my hope was that we'd have as much participation from both in the downtown district, business owners, property owners, residents, planning and zoning board, and the downtown Main Street board, and any other resident who is interested in speaking on behalf of this particular ordinance. And so to me, it made the most sense to have it at the same time the week before Thanksgiving while everybody was still here. And as Mr. Hayes had just explained, he would not be here after the 17th. So if ordinances and notices have already been sent out incorrectly, this is why I wanted to make this change so that we could catch it in time, so that not only do we spend the money and time to invite as many voices that are invested in the downtown, but that we have a meaningful meeting and not have a high level of absenteeism.
Well, first of all, the notices were not sent out incorrectly. There was discussion had, and that's how we normally do the process, is we get the Planning Commission again to meet, and it comes. Are you going to be available on November 21st?
That is the week of Thanksgiving. No, I will not be.
Are you going to be willing to be available on the 21st?
Yes, Mayor.
Councilman Rye, are you going to be available on the 21st of November?
I have to look. I'd have to see my schedule.
Your work schedule?
Yeah, I'd have to see my work
schedule.
No.
That's a regular schedule.
Oh, that's a regular meeting. All right, well, there you go. So we're actually saving the citizens money by not having a special meeting. We're having a regular meeting. Anyway,
it also does give the public two opportunities to potentially, if I can't make one or the other meeting, it does give them the greatest opportunity to have their voice heard.
So I want to be clear. Nothing was sent out incorrectly. It was sent out for proper procedures, and dates were given, notice was given, and mail outs have gone out to the folks that need to be given notice. It's already sent. Councilman
Kane
or Councilman
Ryan,
do you have anything else?
Yeah, I have one other thing. Mr.
Kane
has something.
Yes. When is the planning and zoning scheduled?
It would be November 6th. I think I heard 15th. Well, I heard the 16th, I heard the 15th.
The planning commission currently is scheduled for the 15th and council on the 21st. So this ordinance proposes the 16th.
Yeah. I'm sorry, you're right. Thank you.
Is that 15th meeting, is that a normal meeting or is that a special?
That's actually a special meeting. I was trying to otherwise the planning commission actually it meets the fourth Thursday of the month, and so Mr. Hayes was not going to be here, so we went ahead and scheduled a special meeting for that.
I will be back for the 24th. I just go in the 22nd late that night.
So the
21st I won't be available, but that's not a joint meeting, so my concern there. I feel like special meetings should be time-sensitive matters. And I personally, I don't see the difference between Wednesday, the week in between, and Monday on the regular schedule. I think this is an important enough issue that we need to have discussion and make a decision on it. Sensitivity is enough that we need to do it on special meetings.
May I point out? out, Mr. Kane, that I would respectfully disagree that, in fact, it is time sensitive for the sake, for a couple of reasons. There have been projects that have been put in delay for months, but more importantly, or just as importantly, I will say, you have Mr. Penfield, who has come to the Planning and Zoning Board meetings, Board of Adjustment meetings, Council here tonight, and is expected to try to make sure that his concerns are heard. And I know that for himself and for other residents that live downtown, the way the rule is written currently, the way the ordinance is currently written, it puts them at risk on any given day if any storm comes through and they lose their home. So I would argue that, yes, it is time sensitive. And, you know, it's time sensitive because also, you know, the participation level that we would have in one meeting, we're insured to have, certainly myself, I don't know where Councilman Mariah would be on the 15th, but if we're already having the Planning and Zoning Board being brought together to speak on this particular issue, and the council would be there the same week, the same day, prior to the holiday week. Just in terms of the conversations I've had with residents and owners of downtown, a lot of them are going to be out of town that week of the 21st, and I think it's a disservice to those voices that want to be heard before council, and not just before planning and zoning. And I just would hate for everybody to miss that opportunity, not only to have an opportunity to speak their concerns, but also that we hear them. And there are real time sensitive issues at hand here. It's not simply just a scheduling of giving notice on a regular city council meeting. There's much more to weigh. And so, and I know that the administration is well aware of Mr. Penfield's situation, as I'm aware that the administration has visited with him at his house to discuss these concerns. So that tells me that they are very well aware of the sensitivity of the issue. And so, again, I would request that we put this on the 16th and that we have a joint meeting so that we can have as many voices heard and as many people here available to help us decide.
Thank you, Councilman Pena.
Thank you, Councilman Pena. With that, I'll call the question. For all those in favor of Councilman Pena's motion, say aye. All opposed? Nay.
Nay.
It fails 3-1. The three nays were Councilman Mariah, Councilman Kane, Mayor Bass, and I was Councilman Pena back in the records. Thank you, sir. Appreciation. All right, bigger staff folks. Manny, you have something you want to say. I'm sorry, we're going to go into the general comments one more time because I have one more.
My name is Manny Robinson. I live at 126 West 6th Street, Texas. Styles looking in the bag is a little strange. And today's newspaper, the newspaper article reflects on 10 months of this council and the actions of this council to the citizens of Freeport. 10 straight months. But it's right here. Last council meeting, we just want a letter that we're going to promise to pay back. I don't see that as adequate. I see a bunch of citizens' tax dollars that could be used somewhere else and being wasted on special investigations. When I pay taxes to Brazoria County District Attorney's Office to handle these type of situations, it's not fair to us, and it doesn't show transparency or equality under the law. Now, I live in the downtown area. If I remember correctly, this was voted on when Mr. Bremens was mayor and Jeff Pines was city manager. voted on the zoning of downtown. And all those homes are supposed to be grandfathered in. Every last one of them is supposed to be grandfathered in. So now, we're seeing owners of property that live in my area worrying about if a storm comes, they can't take their house fixed or rebuild their house. It's not right. They're already grandfathered in. And to rezone it for buildings that only three historical buildings is downtown Freeport anyway. The owners of those buildings are carrying the city down, every last one of them. They are carrying the city down because they're not doing nothing with those buildings. Nothing. Look like a dump downtown. It shows our representation of our city when our downtown don't have a heartbeat. That means we're not living. Watching commercialization of a city that I grew up in, watching the straight up commercialization, we're past everything with commercialization, but we seem to have a problem taking care of residents in the city. So at this point, my other concern is why Mr. Bremmer is not here. He has missed too many council meetings. Okay? His temperament has shown on the city council on numerous occasions. Now his employees talk about it and how he treat them at work. Cuss them out and everything else. The city, that's a bad eye. It's a black eye. He's not here. The councilman that's sitting in that seat right here, three council meetings consecutively, he had to go. This council of the city voted out, not this council, but the council voted him out. He had to go. And Mr. Brimmons was one of them that voted him out. So tell me why is the city allowing this to continuously happen when they can fix this problem? Then the citizens don't have to come up and complain about the same thing over and over again, accusing me of all the crimes. Tell me that. Y'all just need to get rid of them and let's get the city on track. Because at this point, Freeport is better than this. I'm tired of being a laughing stock of this county. Y'all have a good day.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Ms. Dancy, I apologize. I got the form. You wanted to speak on number four. Would you like to just make a general comment, ma'am?
Yes, sir.
Yes, ma'am.
Put a bad feeling to a lot of people that if he can state that he's going to vote one way, if he gets upset over a constituent's comment and then decides that he's going to vote differently, that must say something about one's character, I would think. And also, it was stated that he feels as though it's the city that made the mistakes. Well, yes, I'm sure there was some city mistakes, but he should at least admit his part, because he does have a part in it. And Mr. Kelty, this still goes back when looking at all the minutes and the budget back in 2018, there's no way in my mind that this was not known about before then. And this could have been taken care of years ago. So I still feel like people are trying, that council wants to go under the rug, and cronyism is involved in here, and it's a shame, because I love our city. We have a great city, and this should have been dealt with a long time ago, and I feel like council was aware of this, because I don't see how they could not have been aware of this, because if I can figure out things by off my table full of papers and documents that I have pulled and looked at, I might not be a CPA wizard guru, but I know the difference between a credit and a debit. And something's got to change around here. And stop protecting him. He needs to step down, because he's not doing anything for any of us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, ma'am. You know, ma'am, you nailed it. It was 3 minutes and 59 seconds. All right, very good. With that, here's that, folks. Now, item number one, consideration of possible action on resolution establishing guidelines for persons submitting specific redistricting proposals and providing comments. Welcome. Didn't see you last time. Okay.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Great to be here. We've asked you to adopt two resolutions, both of them on your agenda tonight. The first one, the mayor's already identified, on guidelines for persons submitting specific redistricting proposals and or providing comments. What these guidelines are intended to do is elicit appropriate information, in particular things like requiring the commenter or proposer of a plan to identify themselves and provide their comments or their proposed plan in writing. And if you're going to propose a plan, that you propose a districting plan for the entire city and not just your favorite ward. The reason for that is the configuration of one ward can affect all of the others. And we need to understand what the proposed plan really is. So those are really common sense guidelines for public participation. And we ask that you adopt those so that going forward, specific public comments, in particular during an upcoming public hearing on a proposed plan, will be subject to the guidelines.
And are these resolutions, sir, something that your company created?
Yes.
And you have used these with other cities in the past?
Yes.
And the present?
And many local governments, yes, sir.
Very good. Whether you met earlier, I believe, with the Citizen Advisory Committee?
We did.
And did they have any comments or questions on either one of these resolutions?
No, they were fine.
Counselor, do you have any questions for this gentleman? If not, I'll certainly entertain a motion to approve. We'll take them individually. Item number one, which is the resolution establishing guidelines for persons submitting specific redistricting proposals and providing comments.
I'll make a motion, Mayor.
We have a motion to approve by Councilman Kane. Is there a second? I will second it. Are there any further comments? Might I ask, gentlemen, do we want to make sure that we get redistricting done? Not all those in favor say aye.
Aye.
If Councilman Ryan?
I said aye.
All right, thank you. I can't hear on the right ear. Thank you. Betty, passes unanimously. Item number two, consideration of possible action on resolution adopting criteria for use in the 2022 redistricting process. This is what you already discussed previously. Want
yes,
to comment on it just a little bit?
These are criteria that will provide guidelines for the drawing of a new plan. They contain factors such as follow the law, which means in particular accomplish the federally required population balance in the wards, and follow the law with respect to the Voting Rights Act and related federal and state law. Those are mandatory pieces of what you have to do. The rest of them are factors that courts have recognized as legitimate criteria to apply to the drawing of a new plan. And I have to say that it is seldom the case that you can comply with each of them perfectly all at the same time. So there's some balancing and discretion to be exercised by the council in adopting a plan and applying those factors. And those factors typically are fairly commonsensical. Things like use readily identifiable boundary code features, streets, roads, rivers, streams, that kind of thing, as the boundaries, so that the boundaries that you propose for your wards are clearly identifiable. Where possible and to the extent feasible, avoid splitting existing neighborhoods of common interest. Pay attention to county election precincts to the extent that you can, because that will affect the difficulty that the election folks have in designing ballots and conducting the election. Every time you split an election precinct, you have to have a ballot for each side of the split. And while it may not be possible in a city of this size to fully recognize and comply with existing county election precincts, we can pay attention to them so that if a particular choice, a boundary, can be adjusted just slightly to avoid a split in an election precinct, you want to be able to consider whether to do that. Those kinds of factors are, as I said, recognized by the courts as legitimate factors to apply. And we've enumerated a number of them and asked you to adopt those criteria so they can guide the drawing of your new plan.
One of the things that's important for council understanding these criteria, we're basically starting with the existing zoning map and making changes necessary to bring them into balance. So we're not basically starting all over with the redistricting, making the changes as minimally impactful as possible so that people that have a vested interest in a particular elected official, that as much as possible would remain their elected official. Also paying attention to where existing elected officials reside so that the redistricting doesn't necessarily move them from one ward into the other.
Let me comment on that last criterion and just note that that is not a right that belongs to the incumbents. Courts have recognized the underlying rationale as being a representational interest in the voters who elect the incumbent. They have a reasonable expectation that representation should continue to the extent possible. So it is justifiable to pay attention to incumbent residences and not draw an incumbent out of his or her district to the extent that it's possible to do so. So we've been sensitive to that as well.
Thank you, sir. Is there a motion?
I'll make the motion, Mayor.
Thank you, Councilman Gaines. Do I have a second?
I'll second.
Thank you, Councilman Wright. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Motion carried unanimously. Thank you, sir. Item number three, drawing session by Dirk Stafford of redistricting of wards in the city of Freeport.
This is the fun part, and Mr. Bickerstaff and Sherry, Mr. Falk and his assistant Sherry actually able, as we look at the map, to make changes to the house may want to look at and see the results of those.
tolerable in some instances to do that, but it's not necessary.
So at 9.5%, it would require a redistrict?
If you were at 9.5% right now, mm-hmm. you wouldn't have a redistrict.
But you could.
You could. But you're at 16, so you need to. And it will get you down to 9%. More changes, of course, might get you smaller overall deviation, but it's not necessary, and would require a little more movement of census blocks between districts. The other thing I want to point out that I did point out during the initial assessment report, there's an area between wards C and D where the existing district board line splits census blocks, splits 3, 4, 5 of them. And we, not quite arbitrarily, but we assign whole census blocks to either Ward C or Ward D in a way that we keep those districts from being the most or least underpopulated. In other words, it wouldn't affect the overall balance that was achieved in moving the census blocks between Ward C and A.
And I would point out for council, On his presentation, districts 1, 2, 3, and 4 correspond to districts A, B, C, and D.
Mr. Falls, on that map that you had on Ward A, who's in back that where you were at?
Somerset.
Right. Can you zoom back out to the map where you had, 9, 10, 11, 12? East of Alaska.
Can you go back to Ward A? The
District 1.
District 1?
Yes.
Yeah, the Ward A E boundary. Ward A E boundary.
District 1. Yeah, so what you guys were proposing is that where the red line would go? West or east to Alaska?
I should say.
Let me put it back.
Sure. So the red line actually represents the current ward boundary.
So these four blocks right here.
That would put us under compliance. Getting a lot of questions in Ward or District 1, Ward A, because of the jagged streets profiling on this. And I'm just curious, we might just do a clean boundary of the main thoroughfare of Belasco Boulevard, and if that, I know that'll certainly satisfy the threshold of being under 10%. I don't think it'll get us to the 0%. I think you said a minute ago that it's not important that we get to zero, and I can't disagree with that, but I would agree, or I would actually emphasize that it's good for people to just know to have clean boundaries. If we have an opportunity to provide clean boundaries for the residents to know who their council person is and how we can just move forward here meaningfully, I'm interested in that. So, yeah, what is this particular chart reveal?
We did look at that, and it turns out that if we move all of those, you won't be in balance. There's other people.
Does it go back out of compliance?
Yes.
For which ward?
For which ward?
Total out of compliance would be 11%.
We need some population.
Because if Ward B goes to 7.1% below the optimal, and Ward D remains at 3.9% above the optimal.
But that's below the 10% threshold, right?
But you have to look at the low versus the high. So the Ward B, and that's you're looking at 10%. It's not in one Ward being below that, but that
box there gives you the total deviation of most populous compared to least populous.
Mm-hmm.
And the little box right next to it to the right tells you which of the wards are the culprits.
I'm just wondering if you would take it all the way through for all of 12, all the way to Magnolia, if that would still work.
Scania?
Yes.
B?
So if you go back to Velasco like you had it, you already have one side in Ward B, and you just have the other side of your District 2, and then your other side on the other half of Velasco going east would be District 1. Because right now, if you do it like this, down from Virginia, it looks like half will go to B and half will go to A.
On 12. But versus having five different streets trying to decide where their boundary is, it's only one, right? And it's right down the middle.
But that's then to both if it's half of the residents on 11th Street in half the residents on 11th Street, half the residents on 12th Street in Ward B, and half the residents on 11th Street, half the residents on 12th Street in Ward B. So it actually on both, because the line split, so you have the residents on the south side of 12th Street, and the north side of 11th Street are in Ward A.
Oh, you can't move that green to the other side so that it encompasses those houses in the purple, the south side of
the census block boundaries on the middle of the street.
Oh, I see.
The pile house will be on your side.
You can't follow me out of that pile.
I see. What a shame. We can't just say, okay, everybody all on 12.
I think I could now our ability to make a decision that would require splitting blocks.
Yep.
Which
that's just a manual calculation, right?
Sorry.
Just, that would be just a manual calculation versus just relying on the software alone. If that's feasible, is that doable?
At best, it would be something you have to do by hand that makes the software very.
One of the other things that this particular change does is it moves some of the residents from Ward B into Ward A, and some of the residents in Ward A into Ward B. So you're actually affecting more, or disenfranchising more of the current voters than the original proposal.
And I don't know whether these blocks in question have alleys, so you may not have a clean boundary.
No, actually, 8th to 9th has an alley.
But in this particular rendering, the south side of 12th would be Ward A, and the north side of 11th would be Ward A, and everything between in green would be Ward B.
Right.
I like the idea that we can have a human component to it where we can actually just say, hey, it's all of 12th. But I'd rather affect 2 streets than 5 streets. But if we can still affect only 1 street by having a manual human component of your firm's, you know, calculation of just moving the lines or adding up the numbers that way, that would just take leave it to 1 street, right?
If
what
they
have
the population to try to balance population, there's the ability to report the demographics. Because we don't know in that particular block what the demographic breakdown is.
I got you.
And this way, it keeps it clean. We use the census numbers.
Yep. Well,
I'm still okay with one finger affecting basically two streets versus the other model, which had five streets. You guys okay with that? Does that make sense? We want to affect less people, right?
Let's look back at the original model.
Actually, the original one had everybody on one side of Alaska in Ward A, one side on Ward B, except for that one single block, 30, that had 33 residents. They were not, because 21 is the Catholic Church. Is that right? The Catholic Church is. Oh, but that includes. Can you zoom in on 20?
Oh, is it? So the original one had just the finger of 33?
Yeah,
and 21 is
church.
So that would be, what, 7th Street for one city block, basically?
We zoom in on 21 to 33.
Serious question that we're asking, right? About the church having 21 residents on that city block. How do we explain that? There's not 21 residents at a church.
Census Bureau has a very powerful company. When you have this, not every time, but typically when they encounter a city block with a small number of residents, so that it would be possible to look at the published data and identify who is who on that block. They have an algorithm that masks that by moving people around. Way too complicated to try to explain. And they spent months and months having an internal and external expert dialogue about how to do it. This may be an example of that.
Well, that's unfortunate, and it's a very serious matter, I would say, simply because 21 votes, 21 residents, is a lot of residents in Freeport, especially when considering many of the elections that happen in our wards usually are won or lost with less than 20 people. And so to say there are 20 people in one ward or another, and we know that's not correct, as we sit here tonight looking at it, like, that's a church, there's not 21 homes there, there's not 21 residents. We need to make sure that we account for that and the algorithm and how we're doing these percentages so that that 21 is manually overridden as the number one. And I know that's going to affect demographics and what else, but if the data is bad, the data is bad. And, you know, we have a saying in IT, junk in, junk out. So if we have bad data, we're going to be making bad decisions on that data. And so I'm wondering, how can we correct this? And my only thought here is just simply, okay, zeroing that 21 out. And then let the math, let the programmers, manipulate the algorithm so that that's taken into account. And the demographics are also modeled out correctly, because as it stands now, that 21, and now that we bring it up, I'm wondering how many other city blocks have this kind of erroneous information. So, Mayor, I see a bigger problem here.
This is not something that we can fix. The data are reported at the block level. We're stuck with blocks. We're stuck with the way that the census bureau defined them, and stuck with the way they reported the data. Having said that, meeting the federal requirement using census data is an exercise that may or may not have anything to do with the voter registration rates or any of that. It is an exercise in trying to appropriately balance the various wards in toto, and those kinds of plus or minuses are acceptable for the purpose of satisfying the 10% rule. So to some extent, especially since you know that there's been changes on the ground since the census was taken, that you're also not taking into account, it's a little bit
less than a 1% or a 2% margin of error. I mean, if that's what we're going off of, but it's just, like I said, in terms of voter registration, voter participation, 21 is a lot of folks.
Can we see next meeting, or maybe you can send an email to Tim? Can you check last year's census, I mean last year's, 10 years ago, the census to see if they assigned a value, numerical value to that same block?
Apples and oranges, Mr. Mayor. The algorithm that they used last time was very different than the one they're using this time.
Well, I noticed, like I said, Peppermint and Arrington Park are all zeroed out, which would be appropriate. And some other areas that I know that there are nobody there that are zeroed out. I can only see Ward B, primarily a little bit of Ward A. But what you're telling us is these are the numbers that we have to deal with.
Yes, sir.
Can you go back up to districts 3 and 4, please, ma'am?
What is?
Free to try to change if there are particular different configurations you'd like to see. We can certainly do that.
So in this case, you are proposing this. I can't see that street that you have highlighted with red that passes the boundary.
It's M and O.
So you are splitting those streets, or?
No, they currently the red line currently splits those two. Areas, and so with the block that they have, I'm sorry. So that M and O streets are involved. Currently, the line splits those census blocks in half. And what he has done, or what they have proposed to do, is to move one census block into Ward B or C and one into D. So that one is entirely in Ward C and one is entirely in Ward D.
Okay. I mean,
let me try to explain a little bit about why this conundrum probably arose. Sherry, if you'll use the pointer to show the partial street under the boundary. Census block and be right where the boundary is. cannot accurately reflect northern boundaries. And that's possibly what happened or contributed to this as well. Point being, whichever one of you is still here in about 5 or 6 years when they start those programs should remember to remind everybody else that you need to participate in those reporting surveys and report your current matters.
May I ask a question?
Yes, please come up to the mic, sir.
Okay, I'll come up.
Yeah, thank you.
Because this actually affects me. So, question about that. The area that is, can I show you? This area right here, is this considered Ward C? Like it is? So,
in this plan.
In the plan that y'all are proposing. Because right now, I live in that area. I voted, of course, in C, so I would then be moved to Ward D. Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay.
Unless the council makes changes for that particular law.
Okay.
And future plans.
Okay. Just
thank you, sir.
Turn it.
There are a couple of talking points here I think everybody needs to consider. Just look at the election results for Ward A and Ward B in the last two recent elections. In Ward A, it was 119.
Total votes?
Total votes.
Okay.
And in Ward B, it was 154. 21% over 154 is 13%. So we're talking about this 10% threshold that's over. And that's like a real application. I don't want to put it to just our law population. I want to put it to our actual voting population. And the number is 21 over 119. Is that 17%? And I keep going back to this. I want to ignore the fact that what I said earlier, it's only 1% of the total population. The whole purpose of this whole exercise is about how we handle very carefully and very respectfully people's ability to vote, people who are actually voting, and how that counts. So when we're talking about this whole exercise is by law taken in the scope of having this threshold, like for compliance under 10%, you're good, above 10%. Here we have 13 and 17%, it's actually 14 and 18% if you round up, or rounds to the nearest round number, or in nearest integer.
You're assuming, though, that 21 existing in the prior elections it very well may not have.
You don't know.
So we don't know, so we can't say conclusively, but I guess I need some direction. Is there anything we can do about that 21?
I'm also
going
to have a let me say that 21 people, I don't know what your comparison to voters means. I understand where you're heading. But the ideal size is, I think, 2,674. And those 21 compared to 2,674 is a very small percentage.
No, I know. That's what I was saying. It was less than 2%. But then I just try to apply that same, the stronger logic, which is the overriding arch of the whole purpose of this exercise, is how do we balance the vote, right? So, say for example, yeah.
Let me stop you and say the overarching requirement is that, however we do it, you satisfy that 10% requirement, which is based on total population, irrespective of whether a person is eligible to be a voter. So you've got children, you have
I understand the law.
Citizen.
I understand that.
Hold on 1 second, Councilman. Yes. Right. I mentioned it in his answer.
Oh, yeah.
So non-citizens can't vote, but they have a representational interest, constitutionally based, and that's why we use total population as the basis, not
spirit of it, though, is, at least in terms of how we're trying to apply this, is like, there's a reality check here in terms of voter participation across the country, right? So that's why we have these universal laws, these federal laws, and I'm just kind of here to think about here, and we have this small town in coastal Texas, and the percentage of participation is like less than 10%. You know, I don't know if that 10% is the full registered voter. I don't know if the full registered voter is, if our population is 12,000, just round numbers, and we're at 1,200 between all four wards, that's 10%. And I don't know, maybe our registered voter population is 2,400, and it's 20%. And maybe that's where this whole exercise misses, but it's still kind of glaring to me that even though we're here talking about this 21, this church, it makes me wonder how many other spaces and census data points in terms of city blocks are glaringly amiss as this one is. I can look at like where Linda is at now, and there's this block here with 46 and 41. I'm okay if there's some error, you know, there's plus or minus 5 people there.
Where are you referring to, Gavin?
Just in any of these blocks, right? But say there's just plus or minus 5 voters or 5 residents. But when I look at that church, that to me is like, okay, that's not even within the realm of reality. And so I'm just wondering how many other city blocks that we have in here. Unless we go through it, and then, you know, fortunately, I'm not sure if it was Jerry or yourself or Mr. Kelty that identified the church being in that space. And I'm just wondering how many other spots might have that same share.
Can you go down to...
Can I share that there's another area that is, I know for a fact that there's about 63 people that would be in there. You can zoom into there.
For the record, Mr. Matt Morris is an IT guy, so he can probably appreciate junk in, junk out.
Yes, so that's 63. There's probably 7 houses in that entire block. The rest is a church and businesses. So I know for sure there would be 63 people within 6 homes.
Well, the census gives extra for churches.
So, yes. That would be an even more egregious number than the 21.
Well, and I don't want to do Mr. Falk's business, but I would say that, you know, once again, just show of hands how many folks answered the census. There's folks that didn't. And so imagine, you know, you folks are interested and like to come up here and talk and see your government work. Correct me if I'm wrong, Mr. Falk, I mean, it's all just one big statistical analysis based on averages.
No, not exactly.
Okay.
What we're seeing is the result of an actual headcount. Now, COVID happened while this was going on. This census taking was, what adjective should I use, a little more hit and miss than previous censuses. People were not justify the data that it's using instead of the census data. The courts are fairly strict about letting you do that, require a high level of proof that the data you are supposed, that you are proposing to use is more accurate than the census. A very expensive proposition. And while I understand Mr. Pena's concern about the apparent inaccuracies, we're really kind of stuck with the data we've got, like it or not. The algorithm that spreads people in, or camouflages in this case, small numbers of people in a census block, spreads people that are actually in other census blocks. So they're not making up people, they are moving them around to camouflage individual identities. And it may be that the particular line that you pick doesn't include on one side people that have been spread and the spreadees, but on average, it will. It's spread over a relatively small area, not citywide, not ward-wide. It would be a very expensive proposition for you to try to use other data. And again, while I understand where you're coming from in thinking that this is about coming up with an equal distribution of potential voters, that's not what the one person, one vote standard is. It is to balance total population irrespective of citizenship or voting age. And in that respect, trying to fix things or change the boundaries in some way based on an estimation or even an accurate count of voter registration or voter eligibility is really a parallel inquiry not required to satisfy the one person, one vote to 10% rule. It would be very expensive to undertake.
What are you looking from us?
Well, the idea for the process is for you to get to a plan or plans if you want to draw something else or change this one in a way that's slightly different and also have the public comment on, for instance, Plan A. The task is to get to a plan or two that you can designate for public comment for the public to react specifically to in the public hearing that follows and any comment period that you allow written comments to be submitted. With the understanding implicit that you can make changes based on comments or based on later analysis by yourselves and get to a plan that you're comfortable about. So the next step would be to get to one or two plans or more that you feel comfortable enough collectively about to designate for public comment so that we can schedule a public comment, a public hearing, and receive comments for you to react to.
All right. Council, any questions? So the first proposed plan that you have, or the proposed plan that you have at this point, you have titled Plan A?
Yes, sir.
And that's what we're seeing right now.
No, this actually has
this would be B right now.
This would be B.
Oh, I'm sorry. We've got the green down on Plus Street. Can I see Plan A, please? Yes, please.
And the software will only let us open one at a time.
Sure.
Okay.
This is kind of the same of the as the last one. Right?
The only difference.
What's the difference?
The difference between this one and the other one, this peak makes Velasco, the border between A and B, with the exception of that block next to the church. Versus taking 11th and 12th Street, area between 11th and 12th Street.
Oh, so the first one's with Jeff's ideas, or what?
Yeah, but Jeff had, the only difference is Jeff's moved part of Ward A into B, and part of Ward B into A, keeping basically all of the area between 11th and 12th Street.
Can we zoom in again on that green little finger to see the head count?
I think he's talking about the
population counts.
Yeah.
Well, it's a Catholic church, so it'd be
the church.
From 8th Street to 6th Street. That's those two right there.
Yes, sir. This was option A.
Yeah, what you're seeing was plan A. And she's got to turn on the population there.
Mr. Kelsey, what's the timetable that we need to meet in order to, I guess, make sure that the wards are legitimized for the next election?
We have to have a ward map adopted by the first meeting in January.
Okay. I know that the special meeting was held tonight. I was assuming because it had to be expedited here for an aggressive timetable. If we don't pass this tonight, are we still able to meet our timetables?
Oh, we're not going to take action to anything tonight. This is for discussion and that drawing session to potentially develop an option B, an option C, and option D. And we have actually another drawing session potentially scheduled if necessary. But then also after that, we'll have a public hearing. And then any final changes can be made prior to actual adoption. I think my goal was to have it adopted by December, which is about 30 days ahead when we got that and like
that. And what you were looking at with the cross street issue could be Plan B. Yeah. In fact, they've saved it.
Yeah. So. I thought we were going to vote on Plan A tonight. I was like, well, in terms of the data being a really statistical approach, I can appreciate that. Not just save ourselves a whole bunch of workshops.
If anyone, I would recommend it. Go ahead and we schedule a public hearing and get that noticed prior to acting by council. But whether or not you want to have another drawing session is up to council, or whether I know Mr. Falk will be out of town on the 7th.
I would just like Ward A to be in the shade of the state of Texas.
Well, I would say we have the Plan A and Plan B. I'm going to need to talk to and Mario probably as well, Mr. Matt Morris, to see his thoughts about changing from C to B and look at that. But I think we have two plans right now, unless there's anything else the council would get to. But I think we could set it for another drawing or at least a comment section session, Mr. Kelton.
Correct. You're not going to be here on the 7th, is that correct?
That's correct. I'll give you the part.
Okay. So then we'll get back scheduled.
Any last questions for Mr. Falk and his companion? Cheryl.
Sherry.
Sherry.
Sherry. Thanks for the boss.
All right. The boss. Okay. Sherry and your companion. If not, we appreciate y'all coming. I'm sure if Mr. Kelty, Council, if you have any questions or comments, please get them to Mr. Kelty. He'll send them on to these folks. And thank you very much.
Thank you.
block numbers.
Block number in the black, the population division of the block?
Yes.
Maybe hard to display every census block in the city. But what we could do instead is give you copies of, or close-ups of the area that we're talking about for plans A and B, and the area of between C and D where the blocks were split.
I'll make that motion.
I think I heard Mario, Councilman Ferguson, I have a second from Councilman Kane. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you.
Oh, that redistricting map looks pretty interesting. But I know Ward A, the church, that's the biggest question. It's, it has 21 people assigned to it. So that's really, I guess, questionable. There's only the priest that's there. And so something that we'll be discussing later on. Ward C, you see the split that goes on North Avenue. Oh, actually, it splits the residents. On one side of the street, they'll go to Ward D, and the other side will stay in Ward C. And then I believe it was North Avenue T. It split the street in half again. So that's the process of redistricting. And that would level out every ward. It would get us from 16%, which is it's against what the laws say. It needs to be under 10% deviation, 9.95%, 9.99%, something of that nature. But since it was 10%, over 10%, we gotta do this. We gotta redraw the wards. But you saw the biggest changes in Ward A and B and Ward C and D. So we'll see what happens. But that's pretty much it for me. Till next time. Peace out, Freeport.